Koeman sent off in Barca nightmare. Dortmund move for Juve star. Plans for a huge footballing shake-up, a transfer roundup, and today's Friday feels all coming up in the next few minutes. As I'm your host, Matt Froelich. You are the OneFootballers, and this is the Daily News. So first off, and there's quite a considerable amount of pressure on Ronald Koeman at the moment, as last night Barcelona failed to win again. This time it was a 0-0 draw with Cadiz, and it saw Frenkie de Jong get sent off for a second yellow card, and at the end, Ronald Koeman was also given his marching orders, and it really does not bode well for the Dutch manager at the moment. Of course, there's been so much talk about who's going to replace him, or that he's going to be sacked in the next few days. And if they don't get a good result at the weekend or even into next week's Champions League, things are just going to go from bad to worse. And honestly, at this point, I can't see him staying beyond the next couple of weeks. I mean, it's one thing to lose to Bayern Munich, a very good side. Obviously, they don't want to. It's not in their plan. But Bayern are very, very good in the Champions League. But when you can't get results against Granada and Cadiz, no disrespect to them, when you can't play good attacking football and really show basically what Barcelona are all about, that is when the manager's role gets called into consideration. The thing is, though, I'm actually going to stick up for Koeman here quite a bit, because I dare any manager in world football to lose arguably the greatest player of all time, definitely the greatest player your club has ever had, and, well, not really replace him, but deal with the aftermath of this. Not only has Messi left the team, so obviously Barcelona have lost an amazing, the best attacker they've ever had, but also there's a lot of morale to pick up. Barcelona players are thinking about the future. How are they going to be without Lionel Messi? They haven't got their talisman, their club captain anymore. It's going to be a very difficult time. On top of this, they brought in Sergio Aguero, not to replace him, but to be another good attacker. He's injured, yet to make his debut for the club. There's constant injuries with Fati and Dembele, so I think Koeman's not exactly had the easiest time of it. Having said that, on the flip side, it is still his job to galvanise the team, to make sure the team is set up properly and the attackers are getting, well, they're on the good side of some good tactics that gets them the service and the opportunities to go ahead and score. Now, they did have some chances last night, but on the flip side of this, the defence wasn't looking so sharp and Marc-Andre ter Stegen pretty much bailed them out towards the end. Anyway, they pick up another point that leaves them even further behind Atletico Madrid, who are the current pace setters at the moment. On top of this, though, we were talking about transfers and whether or not Barcelona actually did some good business in the summer. Of course, they were under so much financial pressure they could only make a few free signings. But there were rumours that they were looking to bring in the likes of Raheem Sterling or Bernardo Silva, and they offered a couple of players in return, one of them being Ousmane Dembele and the other being Martin Brathwaite. Honestly, Manchester City are looking to excel, are looking to win the Champions League, and Pep Guardiola's hell-bent on domination of English football. So why on earth would he take an injured Ousmane Dembele or Martin Brathwaite, who, let's be honest, is not quite at the level of Champions League winner, and give up Raheem Sterling and Bernardo Silva, two top-quality players? Apparently, the only person that Manchester City were interested in taking for Raheem Sterling was Ansu Fati. But of course, on the flip side, there's no way Barcelona are going to let their young prodigy go. Next up, though, and talking of big players potentially leaving their club, and there's Erling Haaland. Yes, this is going to rumble on for quite some time. Every single time I look at the gossip columns online or in all sorts of newspapers, Erling Haaland has been linked to a new club. So, under the assumption that he's going to eventually be leaving next summer, whether there's a release clause or not, because most teams will pay absolutely ridiculous money for the goal scorer, Dortmund apparently already have a player that they want to sign to replace him, and that is Federico Chiesa. And honestly, I'm not so sure this one's going to happen. I mean, first off, let's get it out of the way that Chiesa's a winger. Haaland's not a winger. Dortmund could do some shifting around in the front line. I'm thinking more Donnarumma, Marlon maybe moving to the centre or signing another player and having Chiesa out on the wing. But I don't see him as a necessary replacement. And also, if Dortmund do put the money forward, Juventus accept it, for some reason Chiesa accepts it as well, I'm not really sure whether it's an upgrade. Like, maybe it's a sideways move from the biggest team in Italy to the second biggest team in Germany. Or maybe it's a bit of a downgrade. It sounds kind of harsh, but there's no way that this is the obvious upgrade in career move. I mean, let's face it, if you're at Juventus, regardless or not whether they're winning the title, the only upgrade for Chiesa would be to move to someone like Real Madrid, Bayern, Man City, Liverpool, Chelsea, Manchester United on top of this. Anyway, there's not really that kind of move, so I'm not quite sure why this one would happen. Anyway, having said that, weirder things have happened in the transfer market, and of course, money talks, but I don't expect to see Chiesa lining up in Dortmund yellow next season. Moving on then, and to Arsene Wenger. Remember him, the one who did so well for Arsenal and then was hounded out by the supporters? Anyway, he currently works for FIFA, and he has been tasked with rejigging the football calendar. And what he's come up with is a World Cup every 2 years.
Oh boy.
Just when we were thinking that players couldn't get any more games into the calendar, they're going to be absolutely knackered. But no fear, because apparently this brand new plan, which I haven't seen all of, just a few bullet points, includes at least 25 days off once a World Cup or a summer tournament has been completed. So, here are a few of the bullet points. By the way, 25 days is nothing. That's like 3.5 weeks for players to recover from what would technically be just over 11 months of footballing action, of traveling around the world and some insane games. Anyway, let's read through a few of the bullet points that I've got down here on my laptop. So the first one, yes, is a World Cup every other year. Then you would have the tournaments like the Euros and the Copa America and the African Cup of Nations every other year. So there would be a major international tournament every single year. On top of this, there will be only two qualifying breaks. Now this one I can kind of get behind. So either in October or March and October, there will be a whole month of international qualifiers. I'm completely against a whole month. That would just be, can you imagine, like stopping the Premier League and all the other leagues, Liga, Serie A, everything else for a month. Oh, it'd be a killer. But on the flip side, it's probably better than stopping every few months, every few weeks. At the moment, there's 5 international breaks in the calendar. I believe there's September, October, November, March. There might be one in August as well. So maybe having them less frequent is good, but a whole month of qualifying action would be pretty mad. Yeah, and on top of this, there's also guaranteed rest periods, like I said, of 25 days after tournaments are over. I just don't think that's good enough. I just think squeezing absolutely every single drop out of these players is going to reduce the quality, it's going to lead to far more injuries, and maybe, this isn't necessarily backed up by any sort of proof, maybe it could lead to players falling out of love with the game as they get later on into their careers. I'm not going to suggest this is happening to any player, although you guys can probably get your own guesses about who I'm talking about. But certainly, a young player comes through, they get given a lot of money, there's a lot of promise, they play in the Champions League, the World Cup, they fulfill a lot of trophies early on in their career. By the time they hit 25, 26, 27, they're absolutely knackered. They've not got nothing left to achieve, but they've pretty much done it all. They've played in all these tournaments because they happen so frequently. They've made more money for 10 lifetimes over. So by the time they're in their late 20s, they can't be bothered with football anymore. And we say it may see a reduced lifespan of a footballer, not lifespan, but actual footballing span of a footballer, because of injuries, because of being overworked, because they really can't be bothered to travel around anymore. Anyway, that might be completely utter nonsense. So next up, let's move up to the transfer news that you might have missed from the last 24 hours or so. So first up, Liverpool are still interested in bringing in West Ham's Jared Bowen. Arsenal could lose Alexander Lacazette on a free transfer next summer when his contract expires. Lionel Messi could miss the Montpellier game this weekend after missing the midweek game versus Mets. And lastly but not least, there was a ridiculous report coming out of Italy this morning. So ridiculous, I didn't give it its own section, but I just thought I'd mention it because it's quite amusing at the end of the transfer bit, that Gigi Donnarumma is unhappy at being benched in PSG. So much so that agent Mineraola is already working on a return to Serie A with Juventus. Oh, there's ridiculous and then there's that. Anyway, let's finally move to Friday Feels, where you guys leave your footballing predictions in the comment section down below and we read out a few of the correct ones on Monday ahead of a massive weekend of football, certainly in the Premier League. Saturday lunchtime sees Chelsea host Manchester City and Thomas Tuchel just seems to be getting the better of Pep Guardiola every single time. And I think he's going to do the same this weekend. 1-0 is my prediction for Chelsea. In the North London derby on Sunday evening, neither team can defend and both teams are half decent in attack. So I'm going for a 2-2 draw. And lastly but not least, in Serie A, Inter Milan take on Atalanta. And what will be an interesting game. And I'm going for a 3-2 victory for Inter. So that's all from me. Then check out everything else we've got going on. Have a great weekend. Enjoy the football. And I'll see you guys next time.